Hello and welcome to The Future Report, a podcast hosted by social research company McCrindle for anyone curious about the future. My name is Ashley Phil, and each week I'll be sitting down with a guest to discuss a topic or trend that you need to know about. A few episodes ago, we spoke about the importance of workplace culture. I think many of us know if anyone is working in an organization, you know the importance of workplace culture, yet it can be hard to define and measure. And I think part of that is because there are so many different definitions of it and there's so much content out there about it. It's also difficult to define because it can be this intangible thing, but it is something that impacts almost all aspects of an organization, from productivity to employee satisfaction and retention. So it makes sense why there is so much out there about it. And we know that culture is also intrinsically linked to an organization's ability to succeed. So today I'm delighted to be speaking to another thought leader in this space, an expert in his own right, especially because he's just released a new book about this topic on culture. So I'd like to welcome Shane Hatton to the Future Report podcast. And just to educate our audience about who you are, Shane, you're an author, trainer, coach, and speaker on the topics of leadership and culture. So we're absolutely delighted for you to be joining us today.
Thank you so much. I've actually been really looking forward to having this conversation with you. It's been planned for a little bit and yeah, so excited to have this conversation.
And I ask this of every guest, Shane, just to help our audience get to know them. And if I know that you've worked with McCrindle, so you probably know that we love to talk about the different generations. And so I feel like it's only fair to let our listeners know what generation do you belong to, Shane?
Yeah, look, I'm a millennial and there's no hiding from it. Yeah, that's definitely me.
Yeah, me too, if that makes you feel any better. And I think we've had Shelley Johnson on the podcast, who I know that you have worked with before, and she's like, oh, classic two millennials, like with their own podcast, talking on a podcast. So it's very on brand for us to be having our own podcast and talking about this topic today, I think. And if our listeners haven't heard of you before, how do you describe the work that you do?
Yeah, I mean, ultimately, the simplest way of describing it is I help people develop remarkable leaders and cultures. And I use the word remarkable very intentionally. For me, remarkable is like every time you say to someone, who is that leader that, you know, comes to mind as someone who had a big influence on your life, had a big impact on your life, or what is a culture that you've been a part of that you always talk about as something that was a standout for you? For me, remarkable, that's what it's all about. It's that being the leader that stands out in people's mind or creating the culture that people talk about and remember over a period of time.
Wow, that's really powerful. And I think, imagine what, as you said that, because I just literally did it as you said it. I was thinking about the cultures that I've been a part of, that I remember, that I talk about positively. And yeah, those remarkable leaders. So that's an incredible purpose and reason for what you do. And yeah. I guess, Shane, with your story and how you came to be working in this area to develop remarkable leaders, could you share a little bit about how that all came about for you?
Yeah, I mean, my journey is such an interesting one because it's this kind of really eclectic mixture of paths that ended up where I am now. And I don't know what your experience is like, but you often look at the thing that you're doing at the time that you're doing it and you think to yourself, like, is this what I'm going to do forever? And then you move out of it and you're like, how does what I did in some way aligned to what I'm doing now? And then you move on to the next thing. It's like, well, like all my paths just seem to be so disconnected. And then all of a sudden you look back over the long period of time and you go, oh my gosh, everything I was doing was setting me up for the thing that I'm doing right now. And so my experience is kind of in this background of, I started in event management. I worked a lot in community groups. So one of my first jobs was coaching community leaders how to run community events with our local council. Then I went into marketing, which again was a bit of a weird kind of sidestep. And then I started a marketing consulting business. And then I did a marketing degree. I went and worked in not-for-profit and I was doing leadership and kind of culture building. And so I've always sat at this kind of intersection of business and people and culture and community. And it's just been this weird kind of group. And now all of a sudden, I find myself in a space where my work is all about building culture. It's all about developing leadership. It's all about, you know, as a practice owner, running my own practice. It's about being able to market myself and develop myself. It's about coaching. And then throw into the mixture of all of that, I did a postgrad degree in counseling. And so now I'm working as a coach as well. And so there's so many of the skills that I learned as a counselor that are helping to shape what I do. So in the simplest way, I tell people I sit between this intersection of people and business. Those are the two things that really inspire me. And all of my work that up until today has usually revolved in one of those two worlds.
Wow, what an amazing journey. And yeah, again, I can certainly agree with that, even when you look back on your life and your work experience and you draw the dots and connections. And yeah, like you said at the time, you're like, they seem random, but then you look back and you're like, oh no, I am using those skills that I developed in that context to help me to what I do today. And I'm sure many of us can think about that. And I think many of us think of careers as just this linear path where you're like, A to B, but actually it's often that kind of hills and valleys and peaks and random side hustles and that sort of thing. So it's incredible, I think, powerful to hear your story and hear other people's stories with their careers. So
I often describe myself, because I'm a learner at the core. That's kind of who I am, big learner. I describe my life as I'm a dot collector. And it comes from this kind of quote, which is the idea that creativity is the art of connecting dots, in which case curiosity is the art of collecting them. And so if I look at my life, I found that my life is just this series of collecting all these dots that kind of connect in this weird and unusual way in what I do now.
Yeah. And I was just thinking as you were talking as well about your comment about connecting business and people. And I know that on your Instagram during the pandemic, because I follow you, and you shared this thing that went like, I don't even know how you describe things that go viral anymore, but that video where you were like on a Zoom call and you're like, don't wave. I honestly think about that video. Like every time I finish it, I'm like, don't wave, don't wave. So relatable. So maybe we can add, you know, Instagram influencer to your
bio. The disappointing thing about all of that is that I could spend sometimes weeks at a time coming up with content to be able to create that has deep and rich thinking behind it, Ash. There's so much thought that goes into it. And I record one video that was just kind of off the cuff as a bit of a funny thing, and it goes completely viral. And look, I'm appreciative of it, but it was also very, very disappointing.
Oh, look, I get it as well. I mean, at McCrindle, we do, and we're commissioned to do so much impactful research, but there's one report we do, which is about baby names. And it's like the thing that we get the most media attention for and traction. And we're all just like, this is so random, but we keep doing it because, I mean, it does have some link to like Gen Alpha, and we like to help parents, you know, who have newborns pick their name. But anyway, it's interesting. And I guess that the focus of today's conversation is, of course, around your new book. So huge congratulations. I know the process and the hard work and the hours and the sacrifice that go into writing a book and publishing a book. So your new book's called Let's Talk Culture, which I have a copy right here. And I'd love to hear what prompted you to write this book at this time particularly.
Yeah, I mean, there's this really great story that I love. And it was a story told by a writer. His name's David Foster Wallace. And he wrote, basically shared it in a commencement address at a college kind of commencement speech. And it's the story about these two goldfish. And it's a very popular story, but it's one that I absolutely love. It's these two goldfish that are swimming in a pond. They're swimming, having a conversation, and another goldfish swimming the opposite direction passes by and says, morning boys, how's the water? And they kind of swim on for a little bit, continue the conversation, then pause, look at each other and go, like, what the hell is water? And there's I love that story because for me, it just summarizes the whole reason for wanting to write this book. And for me, it was this idea that for most of my career and life, I've always been told, hey, culture's so important. Culture's the one thing that's going to make the difference in leadership and in your team. I remember stepping into a leadership role and them saying, hey, culture's your responsibility. And me going, yes, absolutely. Culture's my responsibility. And then like the goldfish swimming on a little bit and going, hang on, like, what's culture? Like, what on earth is culture? I'm like, everyone's talking about culture, but I have no idea what it is. Mm. And I got the inkling that there were a lot of people who are in a similar place that talk a lot about culture, but still struggle to really understand exactly what it is.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, we've done a lot of research, I mean, for your book especially, and then even for a book that we wrote pre-pandemic actually called Work Wellbeing. And we talked about the importance of culture in that, and we even found that as well, that there's so many people who have bought into the idea that it's important and agree, but then when it comes to defining it or having practical strategies as someone who wants to better the culture of an organization, or if you feel that responsibility as a leader, it can be difficult because there's so much out there, yet it can still be vague. So I feel like there's definitions, and I mean, I'm obviously so excited about your book, partly because we worked with you on it. And, you know, it's not just, I mean, obviously it's your anecdotal thoughts and ideas, but it's backed by research, which we love. We love, you know, research and challenging people's ideas with data and evidence-based and the relevance of that, you know, in a world of fake news and lack of trust. And I think, yeah, we had the privilege of doing that research for you. How did that research go from your perspective? How did you find it? How did it help formulate or challenge some of the ideas that you had, I guess, percolate or had been percolating even before you came to sort of sitting down and writing it?
Yeah, I have to say, and you may not know this, I have been like hanging out for an opportunity to be able to engage McCrindle at some point to do research for me. I remember it probably 5 years ago, it might have even been, maybe 4 or 5 years ago, I met Grant at a conference that we were at together. And I remember having this conversation about the work that McCrindle does. And I walked away from that conversation. I said, okay, at some point in my life, I don't care when it is, it could be now, it could be in 20 years, I'm doing something to work together. Because I often think to myself, like for me as a, I see myself as very much as a creative at heart. And so I tend to, if there was the left and right brain, I'm definitely more of that right brain creative. And I think my special skill, if it was, or my superpower, is distilling, I guess, complexity down into simplicity. And so that's a really great skill set. But when it comes to the analytical side of things, I still, that's not what I would say is one of the strengths that I would lean into. And so I just knew that if there was ever an opportunity for me to be able to work with McCrindle, there would be this really nice balance between something that's thorough and something that's elegant. And I really wanted both of those things to work together. And so when I thought about writing a book on culture, to be honest, the first thing that went through my mind was that I'm terrified of writing a book on culture, because if you want to start an argument amongst people who are clever people, throw culture into the mixture of it, because it is the most debated. There is culture crusaders everywhere on a mission to tell you what culture is. And so I said, if I want to step into that arena, I'm not going to step in with just purely anecdotal experience. And I do have experience, but I didn't want to just step in with experience. I wanted to step in with research. And that's where I think this is a really nice partnership.
Yeah, absolutely. How did you find, I mean, that's the great thing with research is almost like the more you do, the more questions you have about a topic.
Yeah.
And that curious, and probably like you said, you're a learner, you're a curious person by nature. How did you find all the data and the insights, and there was qual and there was quant. How did you find mining all that? I mean, I guess you would have just been so excited because it's a topic that you're passionate about and you're getting people's stories and stats. And did you just enjoy the process?
I mean, I love the process, because I think in my mind, and potentially even people who are thinking about going on this process of engaging someone to do research for you, you really have to lean into the expertise of people, you know, like yourselves and at McCrindle. Because for me, I have this tendency, or for a couple of things, is just to go, oh, this seems like a really good question to ask. And then you go, well, actually, if you're going to ask that question, what's the purpose of what you're looking to get out of that question? And how, what kind of question do you want to ask? Is it just a scale? And how many points should be on that scale? And I sit there and go, that's way over what I'm used to thinking about. I just want to know the answers. And so it was a really fun and engaging process, but I found it to be a bit like, depending on what your drink of choice is, like coffee tasting or wine tasting. If you go wine tasting or coffee tasting, you can say, okay, is the wine good or is the wine bad? Is the coffee good, the coffee bad? But if you really tap into the flavors of it, you can actually peel it back and go, oh, there's a savory note, there's a sweet note, there's a sour note to that. And you might go, oh, that's it. But if you peel it back even further, you go, there's chocolate in there, there's, you know, honey in there, there's berries in there, and you pull it back and there's even things like lemongrass or like all these weird flavors to it. And so I felt like as I was getting research back, I was sitting going, we peeled back 5 or 6 layers and it just revealed that there's so much more below the surface than what we even anticipated or expected. So yeah, it was energizing. It was enriching. It was, as a learner, it was extremely stimulating to be able to get all that insight, but just ultimately super, super valuable.
Yeah. And I think that's a really great analogy in terms of, yeah, topics aren't black and white, they're nuanced and they're complex, especially like you said, and I think we both agree around the topic of culture. And I mean, this is a big question. I don't know if there's anything that's top of mind or that sticks out to you, but was there anything from the research that was a huge surprise or that you weren't expecting around the findings, and did that challenge you in any way?
Yeah, I mean, there were a couple of things that stand out to me. Probably the first one was we asked the question, do you think culture can be influenced, or can culture be influenced, or does it just happen? And I think the research said that one in two Australian managers said culture can't be influenced and it just happens. And that was so confronting to me because it almost painted this picture that culture was just up to fate and maybe you might end up with a really good culture or maybe you won't. And that's really just really scary. And as we dug deeper into that, there was probably more nuance to it than just that confronting statistic, which was really valuable to learn. But still, even in the midst of that, the fact that there are some managers out there who believe, you know what, if this is the culture that I have, unfortunately, that's just the culture that I've got and there's not a lot that I can do about that. And so I feel like part of my mission is to change that for people and to help them realize, you know what, if the culture is not something that I enjoy here, I can do something about it.
Yeah, absolutely. And another question I'd love to hear your thoughts on, Shane, is I think we've had conversations internally about this. We've had conversations before on the podcast around whose responsibility culture is to, impact that. Like, is it everyone's responsibility? Is it more a leader's responsibility? What's your perspective on that?
When I set out, I wanted to know what people thought about that. And I think the thing that's unique about the research that we approached in terms of the work that I do on culture is there's a lot of people who talk about culture, but typically they look at how do people in influential positions in organizations shape the culture. So they look at the CEO, they look at the C-suite, they look at people and culture, they look at the culture leaders, and they ignore this huge mass, this critical mass in the middle of the organization, which is the middle manager or the people leader. And I actually think they play such a critical role in it, but they often don't see themselves as a critical player in that. And so we asked them in the research, we said, who do you think is responsible for setting and shaping culture? And we actually said a whole lot of different things. So we said setting the culture, leading the culture, communicating the culture, living it out every day, and addressing the cultural inconsistencies. And when we asked middle managers, they basically cascaded that down from top down. So they said, who's responsible for setting it? Well, obviously that's the head of the organization or the CEO. We said, well, who's responsible for leading it? Well, of course, that's the C-suite or the executive team. And then we said, well, who's responsible for living it out every day, communicating it and addressing all the cultural inconsistencies? And they said, well, that's us. That's the managers. And three of the five kind of areas of culture were being driven by the middle of the organization. And yet they still struggled to see themselves as cultural leaders. And so a big piece of my work is trying to help middle managers to understand, actually, yes, there's a responsibility of the head of the organization to set some direction around culture. Yes, the C-suite and the executive team are responsible for leading it and exemplifying it and role modeling it. But at the end of the day, every single person in the organization plays a really critical role in deciding what's the culture that we're going to build in our team. And that's a big part of what the work that I'm doing is trying to achieve.
Yeah, wow, that's fantastic. I love that. And even just what you shared then, that the nuance even in that question around whose responsibility is it? Well, there's actually different elements, like you said, leading and communicating and dealing with when culture's not right. That's fantastic to hear. And I think that's going to be really helpful for people as they read through the book. Another big question for you, I guess if you're thinking about, or someone's, you know, looking at the book or wondering, is this for them? What would you say to them in terms of what they can expect to be some of the key takeaways to be from it?
Yeah. I mean, the tagline for the book is the conversations you need to create the team that you want. And that's ultimately the whole book is built around having open and honest conversations about culture. And I think if you think about culture and go, well, what's the whole purpose of culture? We often get caught up in the definition of culture and we go, okay, well, how do you define culture? And that is so complex and nuanced. And the question that I ask, which is probably the more in question, is what do you want to use culture for? Like, what's the purpose of culture? And from my perspective, culture in an organization is all about making our differences work at work because we show up with all of these differences and it's the way that we do things, right? You talked about that a few episodes ago and said culture is the way that we do things. The challenge is that we often show up into a workplace and culture is the way I do things, or the way that I do things is this way. And all of a sudden, I have a conversation with you, Ash, and you go, well, I do it this way. And we go, well, who's right in this conversation? And the answer is maybe we both are. Maybe there's no right or wrong to the way that we do things, but maybe we now need to decide together what's the way that we want to do things. And so culture helps us to have those conversations so that all of those differences aren't excluded or ignored or removed from our workplace, but that we can find something that helps us align around those differences and helps us to work together more effectively. And so I think if people are reading the book, the whole purpose of the book is to give leaders practical conversations that they can have with their team so that they can help create the culture that they want.
Mm, that's fantastic. And yeah, I think that's going to be really helpful for so many people, even if they're not currently a leader, but are aspiring to be one or, yeah, because I think all of us need to learn how to, I guess, deal with confrontation. And I know there's some really great, research that exists and some other work. One of them is the 5 Dysfunctions of a Team by Patrick Lencioni. And we've talked about that even in our organization is, okay, you know, what are those barriers that maybe don't think exist, but we just need to be aware of, because we're all people, like you said, coming with our own contexts and ways of working and expectations, and people are, you know, messy creatures, you know, maybe hopefully not in the literal sense in terms of our desks, but even though that can be the case.
But some are. I've worked with some people and they literally, their biggest point of conflict is just messy desk areas.
Yeah.
But that's just the way that they've always done it. And they don't know that it's unusual. I mean, most of the things that we think are perfectly normal to us are actually very not normal to the people around us. And we don't know that until we show up and people are different to us.
Yeah. And it's that understanding, I guess, and skills of empathy to stop yourself and go, okay, I'm having a disagreement with someone. Let me just look at something from their perspective and understand where they're coming from. And I'm sure, yeah, that the conversations that people need to be having and the skills that we need to sort of apply in those contexts are going to be so helpful. And for us, even at McCrindle, as we think about analyzing the trends and, you know, the world of work has just undergone massive transformation over the last 2 years. And I think all of us can, you know, whatever industry you work in, you can acknowledge that. I mean, both you and I, Shane, are in the area of communication. We're used to going out, speaking at events. We were just chatting offline before of how we're kind of now transitioning back into the in-person. But workplaces are doing that too, and work has changed. How important do you see culture being to successful organizations in the future? I mean, even as we work in more decentralized ways, as work from home, I mean, do you see another challenge or a contextual challenge there around culture?
Yeah. I mean, it's always going to be the same. The challenge for culture is always that culture will be more interpreted than it is explicit.
Mm.
And that's where the biggest dilemma I find. So whether it's we're working in an office together, we still have to interpret the culture, or whether we're working remotely, we still have to interpret it. And Tori Leto's got this really great quote, which is, whatever isn't communicated is felt. And what is felt is interpreted, and what is interpreted is often misinterpreted. And so most of the conversations around culture is that if I was to ask you to describe the culture of your organization right now, what you're doing is kind of interpreting your experience.
Mm.
And so if I was in a big organization and I went to the, you know, someone who is an executive leader and I said, describe the culture of your organization to me, they might say, well, it's kind of flexible and it's adaptable and it's inclusive and it's, you know, this or it's that. I might go to someone completely in a different department of the organization, say, describe your culture to me. They might say, it's, you know, it's toxic, it's exclusive, it's, you know, it's rigid, it doesn't let people, you know, it doesn't trust people. Same organization, but two very different experiences. And it's usually that person's kind of interpreting their own experience in the organization. And it's because most of the time as an organization or as a leader, we don't explicitly tell people the culture that we're either trying to create or that we're aspiring to. And so we allow people to kind of just interpret it through the lens of their own experience. Whereas if you said, hey, I really want to create an organization or culture that is, you know, it's flexible. And this is what that means. And this is what that looks like in action. And this is how we talk about that. And this is how it shows up in our workplace. And we all work towards that same objective. Over time, eventually, you're going to see more and more people when they say, what's your culture like? They would say, actually, our culture is flexible and it's inclusive and it's adaptive and it's all of these kind of things that we've aspired to, because we're all pointing at the same thing and we're all looking at the same objective. And so I would say the biggest risk, whether it's in the office or whether it's remote working, is that we leave culture open to interpretation rather than making it explicit.
Mm, absolutely. Yeah. And I think many leaders, I think, would be thinking about that in terms of, yeah, how they communicate well, how they maintain maybe cultures that they had made progress to building or communicating or aligning, like you were just mentioning there, maybe pre-pandemic, but then in the last couple of years, like it's hard to imagine, I think, for me, because we have a relative or a small to medium-sized organization. We've got a couple of different locations across Australia and internationally now, actually. But we came back pretty early in the process. And I think for us, you know, we tried to be really intentional. We try to live out all the things we advise other organizations on through our work and our research. But yeah, even that constant kind of revisiting of purpose and values and bringing them into the conversation regularly in our team so that they're lived out, they're spoken, rather than just something that we maybe talk about at offsite team days at the beginning of the year or something like that. But then I can imagine if you've if you're in an organization that hasn't come back to the office like ever, I mean, I just recently read that Airbnb have announced that they're going to be like fully virtual moving forward. There's going to be no pressure to come back to the office. You know, that'd be really interesting, I guess, employee experience, especially if you've come into an organization, if you've never met your people leader in person. So I wonder, you know, do you have any insights or tips for people who are leading those remote teams about, I guess, the conversations maybe they need to be having with their people around how they sort of continue to, I guess, create that culture they want to see, talk about it regularly. Is that the solution, just to keep it front of mind and keep it in the conversation?
Yeah, I mean, I would suggest that most of our biggest challenges in leadership and in business can be traced down to a communication challenge and can most often be resolved with a communication solution. It's like most things in life. It's an ongoing conversation. So if you think about something like, just look at a personal level. If I said, what are your values right now? You might say, oh, I did a values exercise once. It was maybe a few years ago. And these were my core values. And as you reflect on them, you go, yeah, they're pretty much still my values. Like, they're still things that are really important to me. And yet in 6 months' time, I could have a conversation with you and you could have gone through a massive personal disruption. Maybe you were hurt by somebody, someone's really offended you, or someone's really, you know, had done the wrong thing by you, in which case now honesty and integrity rise to the surface for you and they're really, really crucial and important values. And yet you'll find that probably most of them will stay the same, but maybe the frequency of them or the ordering of them might differ slightly. And it's the same with an organization. So if you were pre-pandemic, if you were an organization that valued autonomy and flexibility and, you know, this sense of initiative that came from employees, they're probably still things that you value post-pandemic. They're still things that are important to you. And yet the expression of those things looks very different. So pre-pandemic, you might have said, flexibility for us means you can come into the office anytime you want and leave whenever you want. But at the end of the day, we still want you to work in the office. Now, post-pandemic, flexibility might say, you know what? We actually don't care whether you come to the office. You can work wherever you want. We're going to measure you based on outcomes. So it's still the same, but it's slightly tweaked. And so the only way that you can actually make sure that that's going to be front and center for people is to keep coming back to the conversation and ask yourself, number one, what's important to us as a team? What do we expect of each other? And then number two, what does that look like in action? How would we practically know whether we're being able to achieve that? And I think they're just two ongoing conversations.
Yeah, they're great. Fantastic tips. Thank you for sharing. And I guess for someone listening to this, I mean, I have certainly been convinced about the importance of culture, even though I was kind of already predisposed to that and valuing it. But if people are, you know, convinced that it is important and they are keen to read your book, hopefully, then, you know, do you have any final tips for people who are keen to do that?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think one of the questions I'll often ask leaders is to go, talk to me about the ideal qualities of your team. So when I say the ideal qualities, if you could use a few words to describe your team to be at its best, what kind of words would you use? And they might say, oh, I want a team that's optimistic. I want a team that takes initiative. I want a team that is honest. I want a team that is this or that. And then the second question I'll ask is, when was the last time you told your team that? And more often than not, the answer is, oh, I don't think I ever have. And in which case I'll often say to them, so how does your team know that that's what the culture you're trying to build is? And they go, well, I guess I get angry when they're not optimistic. I get frustrated when they don't take initiative or when someone does, I make sure I go over the top and celebrate them about that. And so most of the time, the team are learning about culture through what we celebrate or what we confront. And I think if we can be a little bit more intentional to say, hey, what is the ideal qualities of the team that I want to create? How do I have that conversation with my team? I think we're better positioned to be able to celebrate more meaningfully. So when we say, hey, thank you for doing that, we're celebrating something that we've already said is really important to us. Or when we say, hey, don't do that, or hey, that's really not okay here, people understand why we're saying it's not okay because we've already explicitly agreed together that's not something that we want to create. So the most important thing, like anything else, is communication. It all comes back to communication.
Yeah. And like you were sharing, I think earlier, even that question that we asked in the research about whether culture can be influenced. And I think, Yeah, but something we often talk about as well is to be intentional and to, yeah, have those conversations and keep that communication up, like you shared, because, you know, culture is developed in an organization. And even just I'm reflecting and connecting all the dots, like you said earlier, just or even around what other gems you've kind of dropped even in the podcast around what people feel and their experience. And it is developed whether we're intentional or not. But I think as leaders, as people who are in an organization who are tasked with creating and developing culture, there is a real opportunity for us to be actually intentional about it, whether people are, like we talked about, working from home or if they're in the office. And I guess that's the what I was trying to say earlier, which I feel like I butchered a little bit, was just what tips do you have aside from going to buy the book? And that would be my takeaway tip, is for people to go out and buy this book. I mean, obviously we back it because it's research based and we had the real privilege of working with you on that. But also, yeah, we know and so many of my colleagues can vouch for your passion for this topic, Shane, and for, yeah, your experience and expertise in it. So really delighted to have you on the podcast today. Thank you so much for coming on. Thank you for doing the important work of, going through the research process. It can be confronting and challenging, we found, for organizations and for leaders who have an idea about a topic and then go through that process and dig through the nuance. But you've done the hard work, and it's incredible feeling to hold your work here and for it to be so accessible to so many people. So if people are keen to find out more about you or the book, where should they go? Where would you direct them to?
Yeah, I mean, you can pick up the book in any kind of good bookstore. You can find it online at Booktopia or Amazon. It's pretty much anywhere you find a good book.
Great. And if people want to learn more about you and your facilitation and coaching, where should they go for that?
Thank you. That's very kind. Yeah, ShaneMHatton.com is the best place to find out all about the work that I do. And I spend most of my time hanging out on LinkedIn. That's kind of the space I love to play. So come say hi, connect with me, and would absolutely love that.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much again, Shane, for coming on the podcast today.
It's been an absolute privilege. And thank you so much for all the work that McCrindle did in helping to kind of make sure that this book was not just memorable, but also thorough. It was not only just a really good experience working with the team, and we were just phenomenal people, but I feel like the results that we were able to achieve really helped inform the book to make it really helpful for other people. So thank you.
And yeah, on behalf of my team, you know, you're welcome. And I should shout out on the podcast, particularly you mentioned Grant and also my colleague Shannon, who I know have been really working well with you, working hard, and have just been raving about you and the process and the delight it's been to provide the research for a really great topic that we really believe in. So thank you, Shane. And for all our listeners, if you'd like to stay up to date with our latest insights around work and culture and trends in the future, you can subscribe to the podcast or follow us on social media or head to McCrindle.com. And if you're enjoying the podcast, we would love for you to leave a review on Apple Podcasts or Spotify. So once again, thanks for listening, and bye for now.